So visual loss in association with pituitary tumors is not a new finding. And the fact that people can get better after having their tumors removed is not a new finding. This is from Harvey Cushing's notes, patient in December 1928 with bitemporal visual field loss with postoperative improvement in vision. But today I'm going to try to give you some cues as to what are reasonable expectations in terms of vision protection and visual recovery in your patients. So an alteration in vision is sometimes the first sign of a pituitary tumor. It could be reduced central vision in one or both eyes, or altered peripheral vision, or sometimes double vision. So clinical ophthalmologic evaluation with visual field analysis is indicated. The neuro-ophthalmologic evaluation documents function and form, aids in setting reasonable goals for the patient and the surgeon, aids in developing prognosis, and protects the patient and the surgeon. Recognizing that the pituitary resides in the cella turcica and the optic nerves enter and pass 1 centimeter above the cella should not surprise us in terms of the early potential for visual disturbance in association with expansion in the cella. And the cranial nerves, which control eye movement, are parallel to the cella in the cavernous sinuses. So really, the pituitary gland sits in what I refer to as the nexus of neuro-ophthalmic territory, with the optic nerves in the chiasm just above and the cranial nerves controlling eye movement just lateral in the cavernous sinus. Many pituitary tumors, especially the soft ones, tend to take the path of least resistance, and anatomically the path of least resistance is usually upward. But certainly we see many tumors that will extend or invade into the cavernous sinus and may present with double vision or ptosis prior to vision loss, but more commonly the presentation is with visual disturbance, especially for the non-functioning adenomas that don't have a hormonal presentation. Understanding the neuroanatomy and the wiring of the visual system is helpful in terms of looking at the visual disturbance and anticipating from the visual disturbance where the compression may be in the visual pathway. And typically, there'll be a presentation with bitemporal hemianopsia because at the chiasm, the fibers which project from nasal retina cross. So compressing the chiasm will preferentially disturb the nasal fibers, and because images are inverted inside the eye, the nasal fibers of the retina are receiving vision from the outer or temporal visual field. Looking at the clinical history, we're also looking to see if there's any abnormality evident externally. Is the globe or the eyelid position abnormal? Is the visual acuity or field abnormal? Is there an eye movement disorder? And we're also looking at corneal sensation and sensation in the distribution of the branches of the trigeminal nerve. The pertinence of 7 is not that 7 runs in that anatomic region, but there can be great difficulties with potential permanent damage to the cornea and the eye in a patient who has both 5th and 7th nerve dysfunction. There may be abnormalities of which the patient is unaware, but may become aware of after surgery. So documenting what the visual function is and visual field is before surgery allows the surgeon to avoid a false claim of visual disturbance in association with the surgery. In the examination, we're measuring acuity, visual field, checking to see if there's a relative afferent pupil defect, looking at relative brightness and color sense, looking at the appearance of the optic nerve head, and a wonderful new tool that has allowed us to be more precise is called ocular coherence tomography, and I'll spend some time discussing that today. And looking at ocular coherence tomography, in essence, we're taking a high-resolution image of structures of the retina. And in doing so, we're particularly trying to assess the health of the retinal nerve fiber layer, which are the axons of the optic nerve. There are 1.3 million individual axons of each optic nerve, and they project retinotopically. And ocular coherence tomography is an optical way of looking at the anatomy of the retina. So here is a histologic analysis of the retina, and here is a OCT of the retina. So with ocular coherence tomography, we can see changes in areas of retinal thickness and changes in layers of the retina on the order of plus or minus 5 microns. It's a quick test that is done in this apparatus, and it's really useful in evaluating and monitoring a whole host of things that involve the visual system. We used to think that it was useful just for things that are pre-lateral geniculate, just things in relation to the optic nerve and chiasm, but there has been recent evidence that it's useful in evaluating post-geniculate disease as well, but that's not the subject of today's meeting. Here, for example, of the technology is a woman with acute optic neuritis, a demyelinating plaque in the left optic nerve, enhancement on MR. We're not surprised to see that she may have partial atrophy in that optic nerve, but she has partial atrophy in the other optic nerve as well, which was not symptomatic. And because the optic nerve is a white matter pathway, we're discovering that monitoring retinal nerve fiber layer thickness also tells us a lot about the course of patients with MS. This is a 24-year-old woman with papilledema in association with pseudotumor cerebri, and therefore a thickened retinal nerve fiber layer. And it's a very precise tool for monitoring recovery from papilledema in pseudotumor patients. This is a woman who has compressive optic neuropathy, and you can see in her OCT that she has areas of atrophy, and we would tell her before surgery that she already has some evidence of permanent damage to the right optic nerve. As opposed to this woman who has a normal retinal nerve fiber layer thickness, and we would tell her that the prognosis for recovery is better. Now, the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness is not a real-time assessment of whether or not there's been damage at the chiasm. If one were to, by trauma, cut the chiasm, although there would be immediate irreversible blindness, it takes a month or two before you see changes inside the eye that reflect permanent damage to the vision. So the OCT, or looking at the optic nerve for atrophy, is more a reflection of what the status of the optic nerve in the chiasm was 2 months ago rather than currently. So one has to be cautious not to be too effusive in the quality of the good prognosis in this patient. But on the other hand, in this patient, you can tell them absolutely that although they can hope to be better, that they won't have a complete recovery. In looking at the efferent system, we're also looking at the lids, orbits, and for globe displacement, eyelid position and function. Not every patient with a cranial nerve weakness will have double vision, and there are a variety of reasons for that. So one has to test for cranial nerve function and not rely on a patient's history of double vision to know that the cranial nerve function is normal. We're looking at pupil size and reactions, tear production, and function of the orbicularis. So in doing a basic ocular motility evaluation, and this doesn't require an ophthalmologist in most cases, we're looking at the alignment of the eyes at distance and near, and we're looking at the range of movement of the eyes. And here you can see in left lateral gaze that there's a difference in position of the eyes in relation to fourth cranial nerve weakness. A very sensitive test that any practitioner can do is the cross-cover test, where you go from eye to eye, have the patient fixating on a target on the opposite side of the room, and ask them if the apparent relative position of that target shifts, whether it be a light switch or a letter on the wall. If they say yes, when you go to eye, it's moving left and right, or it's moving up and down, that tells you that there's an inherent misalignment of the visual axes. Not all of those patients necessarily have cranial nerve palsies, but it's a good screening test. When there is a misalignment, we're able to quantitatively measure that by neutralizing the misalignment with prisms, and this is very helpful in terms of monitoring patients in terms of decline or improvement in cranial nerve function where we can quantify it. In terms of visual disturbance, sometimes patients will go months or years with progressive visual disturbance before they come to diagnosis. This gentleman who has what appears to be a meningioma in the suprasellar space compressing one optic nerve was followed as a patient with presumed ischemic optic neuropathy before someone noticed that he was slowly declining in his visual acuity and ordered an MRI. This patient called the office at 9 o'clock in the morning, said, I awakened with poor vision and one of my eyelids is down. He was seen at 10 a.m. He had very poor vision in each eye and third nerve palsy in the right eye. By noon, he had an MRI and he had findings consistent with pituitary apoplexy, and again, the fluid level. And by afternoon, he was operated. So 1 week later, he had recovered normal vision and near complete recovery of his third nerve weakness. And some of the points that will be made in a moment is that the shorter the period of compression and the faster the intervention, the faster the recovery and the better the prognosis. And here's his post-op MR where the compression has been completely relieved. So the goals of surgery are selective tumor removal to reduce mass effect, to reduce visual loss and reduce headaches, to preserve glandular function, and to avoid complications. And you can see a nicely decompressed chiasm here. This is a patient with a large macroadenoma and bitemporal visual field loss, postoperatively nicely decompressed. And on the other hand, this is a patient with macroadenoma, prolactin secreting, treated with bromocriptine. So in a patient with a chronic compression, the immediate therapeutic direction does not always have to be surgery. And the patients with acute compression and apoplexy, although there are some cases of improvement without surgical intervention, I would say that it's best to decompress an apoplectic situation early. In a patient with visual loss from chronic slow expansion from a prolactinoma, it's certainly safe to treat medically, and you can expect improvement, and there are many cases documenting improvement with medical treatment of prolactinomas. And there's another patient with treated with cabergoline who also had good shrinkage of tumor and good vision recovery. In a paper published by Nanalingham in the Journal of Neurology and Neurosurgery Psychiatry in 2004, they looked at 41 patients with macroadenomas. 29% had visible optic atrophy, but they had visual field improvement that they reported in 95%. Where 35% recovered to normal function, 60% showed improvement. So the prognosis for improvement in many cases is very good, and their predictors of visual field recovery obviously were shorter duration of symptoms in those patients who had better visual function before surgery. Their study went on to note that some of their patients had continued improvement for periods as long as 5 years. This article from our group, many of the authors of whom are here today, looked at 51 patients with large macroadenomas over a 10-year period. These were tumors greater than 4 centimeters. 41% had gross total resection, 20% had near total resection. And among 38 patients who had pre-op visual field loss, 31 or 81% had improved acuity in visual fields, and none of the patients had worsening of vision. In this patient by Suri et al. From India, they looked at 79 patients with varying degrees of visual dysfunction, most of them with severe visual dysfunction, and they found that the factors associated with the likelihood of visual recovery, again, were short duration, apoplexy, soft tumor, transphenoidal approach. Basically a shorter duration of visual decline and blindness were the strongest predictors of visual recovery. So those things that make sense to us empirically and we see clinically are documented in the literature. In this article by Lubina, they looked at patients with pituitary apoplexy. 61% had visual field defects, 40% had ocular paresis. And they had 81 and 71% statistical improvement rates. In this patient from Komatar et al. And Ted Schwartz, looking at craniopharyngioma cases, they noted better visual outcomes with an endonasal versus a transcranial approach. Most craniopharyngiomas are retrochiasmal in location, but still can be approached transnasally in some cases, or by a brow approach in some cases. And in this paper by Danish Meyer et al., they looked at OCT. and it's been demonstrated that patients who have objectively measurable retinal nerve fiber layer loss at the time of surgery for chiasmal compressive lesions are less likely to have return of vision or visual field after surgery. But again, it's not an all or none phenomenon. The patient who has evidence of retinal nerve fiber layer thinning before surgery should be counseled that they won't have a full recovery, but many of them do have an excellent recovery. In terms of rehabilitating motility for those patients who don't lose their double vision after surgery, there are many ways of doing that with Botox and Prism and some surgically. This is the application of a paste-on prism that can be used to improve binocularity in a patient who's waiting for improvement in cranial nerve function. Does anyone know who this is? Hillary had sixth nerve weakness for a period of time, which she wore a Fresnel prism for. And surgery can be utilized to restore single binocular vision as well. It's often overlooked that when you're thinking of radiotherapy, that there is a small risk of radiation optic neuropathy. Certainly if the retina is included in the radiation field, radiation retinopathy, as illustrated here. But we worry about the most is those patients who may show up with radiation optic neuropathy, typically a year or two after radiation. In these patients, the eye exam may be normal, but they do have characteristic MRI abnormalities that would speak for radiation damage. So in planning, does the patient need treatment or observation? Sometimes it's okay to keep your tumor. What are the therapeutic options in terms of medication, surgical decompression, biopsy, debulking, excision, or radiotherapy? What are the surgical approaches? And a careful examination of the visual system is very helpful in allowing one to make those decisions and share the prognosis with the patient. Thank you.